listen to the book of 1 Thessalonians, chapter 5. Chapter 5 and verse 23. And the word of God says this. God's word says, may God himself, the God of peace, sanctify you through and through. Everyone say through and through.
Amen.
So God wants to sanctify us completely through and through. And then the next line explains to us what it means to be sanctified through and through. What it means to be sanctified completely. It describes our whole being as a human being. Let's look at the next sentence. The same verse, verse 23. May your whole, everyone say whole.
Whole.
Whole means complete you as a human being. We are three parts, okay? Whole spirit, soul, and body. You are a spirit, you have a soul, and you live in a body. And all of these three aspects of your being was created by God. You can say amen.
Amen.
And it's important to you. Everything that's created by God is important. Our bodies, though it's temporary. Tell your friend, your body is temporary. Come on. Your body is temporary. Though it's temporary, it does not mean it's not good. It does not mean it's from the devil. It is meant for this earth. Okay? You've got to be real. There's three parts. Our spirit, our soul, and our bodies. Our spirit and our souls will come with us to the next life. But this body will have to be buried. If you cannot imagine, always try to think of us as the egg. The shell is like the body. Okay, the yolk is like the spirit, the soul maybe. And the white egg, white is like the spirit, transparent. Okay, but our body is like the egg shell. It's only good for now. Once the chick is hatched, the shell is nothing. Who can say amen?
Amen.
You know, we know like, wow, we want what's inside the egg. Who eats an egg and give so much attention to the shell? We just throw the shell into the bin. Isn't it? We want the egg, we want the white and the yolk. So the shell is necessary. Without the shell, without the egg shell, the egg yolk and the egg white cannot be contained. So it's important. That's why God created the eggshell as well. Who can say amen?
Amen?
But it's temporary. It's to be thrown eventually. It's to be decayed. It's to become dust. That's how it was from the very beginning. We came from dust. And the part that's dust in us is our flesh. So this will cause us to think. Too often we give too much attention to this part that is going to be thrown into the bin. We give too little attention to our soul and to our spirits. But we give so much attention to our bodies. And I'm one of them. Massages, facial, good food. That's why I'm in the season of fasting. You know, God has spoken to me as I always preach the sermon that is always related to my spiritual journey. I'm in the season of fasting. I'm trying my best to eat one meal a day. And then just go on liquid throughout the whole day. To kind of give less attention to this body that's going to the bin, that is going to be decayed, eaten up by worms. You can say amen.
Amen.
Say amen.
Amen.
Tell your friends, your body is going to be eaten by worms someday. Come on, tell your friend. Let's be real, be realistic. It's going to be eaten up by worms someday. Yes, like it or not. Okay, that's going to happen to you sooner or later. I was in another church this morning. Just I go to church every Sunday morning to a different church to sit down and to receive. Because as a pastor, I'm always giving. So every Sunday morning, I go to a different church to sit down and just receive. And there was a preacher preaching. And I've never heard him before. He was sharing about how his little baby died a few months ago. Little baby Hannah. I don't know if you heard of baby Hannah died in an accident recently. 2-month-old Hannah. And the father was preaching in the church that I went this morning. So he was sharing. He was speaking about forgiveness. How important it is as Christians to forgive. Because God says, still, if you can't forgive others, don't expect me to forgive you. Amen. Like it or not, no matter how nice a person is beside you, that person will hurt you. And your job is not to hold on to the hurt, but to forgive. Who can say amen?
Amen.
And God says you got to forgive 70 times 7 times. In other words, 490 times. That's a lot. Tell your friend beside you, let us keep forgiving each other. Come on. Let us keep forgiving each other. So I was moved. He's not a fantastic speaker this morning. His tone was very monotonous. I didn't know he's the father of Hannah, so I was just listening, okay. Oh God, speak to me, speak to me. So when I listen to preachers that is a bit boring, I'm like, okay, I try to stay awake, I try to stay awake. So boom, he broke the news. I'm the father of baby Hannah. I was like, wow. And he started to cry. He was sobbing, and I started to cry, of course, obviously. I was crying, I was so moved. He said, you know, it's not difficult, it's not easy for me to preach this sermon. Because I had to forgive the person who killed my baby. I had to, and this, the person who killed his baby, it was an accident. And this man and his wife just parked their car waiting at the traffic light. They were not even driving. It was stood still, got the traffic, waiting for the light break to turn green. But on the other lane, this 19-year-old kid was late for class, speeding, zoom, bang, the divider. And the divider banged the car of this couple and hit all of them, and especially the baby. Baby hit down on the spot, the head swelled and then died eventually. So the mother of this 19-year-old kid went to apologize, and this couple says, I want to see your child. We need to see your child. The 19-year-old person, I don't know, male or female, and not to beat him up or her up, I don't know, but to say, I forgive you. I forgive you because my Jesus forgave me. So that was powerful. You can say amen. He practices what he preaches. That's what Jesus wants us to do. Not just talk about the things of God, but do the things of God. Let us be doers who can say amen. Who can say amen? We are to be doers. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. So we have a spirit, we have a soul, and we have a body. The title of my sermon this morning is Real Drink and Real Food. Real Drink and Real Food. Every part of our being, our spirit, soul, and body, our spiritual, need food and drink. Come to the body part, everybody knows, right? We need food and drink for the body. Okay, and if we are wise, we will go for the best. The healthy food and healthy drink. Instead of beer, we go for fruit juice. Instead of junk food, we go for extra veggie, olive oil. For those who are wise, they take care of their health. That is good. Who can say amen? But how do we take care of our soul? And how do we take care of our spirit? So today my sermon is to teach us from God's word how to feed our spirit. But before we talk about that, let's talk about soul, which is not part of my sermon, but especially we have babies in this house, babies to come, and many of us are parents or parents to be. Even our soul can be fed. Okay? The body is easy, food and drinks. And try our best to get healthy food and healthy drinks. The soul, the only thing that can feed the soul of a human being is love. Everyone say love.
Yeah.
People's love. Okay? A child needs love. Masculine love, particularly the father's love, is drink to the soul. Okay? Drink to the soul. Mommy's love, feminine love, is food to the soul. Okay? That's another sermon I'm going to preach on that. I always teach on that when I give my victory talk. That's why a lot of people, in their soul, they are very thirsty or very hungry because never had masculine love and never had feminine love. Okay, but that's not my sermon. My sermon is how to feed the spirit today. Tell your friend beside you, your spirit needs food. Come on, your spirit needs food. Okay, and we cannot neglect this. Now I look around and I am very sure none of you are neglecting in the area of feeding your body. You all look very healthy. Some of you look too healthy. Okay? And so, I don't know, but like for those of you I know, some of you are not too bad. You know, your father's loving you, your mother's loving you. You know, the spirit part, that's the part that is most important. So I said earlier, I am a spirit. I have a soul. I live in the body. The real you is not even the soul or the body, but the real you is the spirit. I'm not a soul. I'm not a body. I am a spirit. I have a soul. I live in the body. So tell your friend, you are truly a spirit. Come on. You are truly a spirit. Yes. And the spirit. those who don't know, your soul is your mind, your will, W-I-L-L, the part of you that says, I will do that, I won't do that, they all come from your soul. And your emotions, that's your soul. That makes you, that makes the unique you. And I will hold on to my soul. Even the next life, I will still have Edmund Smith's soul. I'll have a brand new body who can say amen, but not a brand new soul. I will still be Edmund Smith, you will still be Michael Teo, you'll still be Jeremy Lin in the next life. But a perfect Edmund, a perfect Mike, a perfect Jeremy, and the rest of you who can say amen. The soul will be transformed, but you'll still be the same, but I'm not going to be Michael Jackson in the next life. I'm going to be Edmund Smith still. Who can say amen? So you're going to take care of your soul because it's going to be forever. And you're going to take care of your spirit especially. So it's quite difficult to imagine what your spirit always similarizes into your body. It's not the same thing, but it is similar. The spirit and the body contains the soul. You don't want to say contains. Like a container. Okay, the spirit and the body contains the soul. That's the first thing. That is the function. And the second would be the spirit and the body has the five senses. There are five senses, right? The sight for the rest of the body. You have a sight, you have your hearing, you have smell, you have touch, and you have taste. Those are physical senses. Same thing for those who are born again. Everyone say born again? What happens when you're born again, and you get born again, your spirit becomes alive. Those who are not born again have spirits as well. Say amen. Amen. Don't think that only you have spirit. Everybody has got spirit. Every human being has got spirit. But for those who are not born again, their spirit is, some call it dead or asleep. But you're born again through Jesus Christ, your spirit becomes alive. And the spirit has five senses too. So that is why when you grow spiritually, you'll have spiritual sight. You begin to see things that other people can't see. Maybe ghosts. Maybe all kinds of angels. You can see things. I look at Eileen, I'll be able to see things that all of you might not be able to see if my spiritual sight is sharp. Are you listening? So that spiritual sight, spiritual, you can hear things. And with, not with the physical ears, but with the spiritual ears. You can smell things. Pastor Amanda always smells things. One of the things that she smells is death. She goes to a certain place, she smells in the spirit to spell death. And she knows it's death. The spirit of death is present. And in our experience so often, she walked to a house, the spirit of death, and 1-2 weeks later, we hear someone die. I said, you should have prayed against death. You know, she smelled death right now. So there is a reason why you smell, or why you see, or why you hear, or why you taste in the spirit. So you have five senses for the body, you also have five senses for the spirit. Are you following? Okay, and the spirit and the body's function is to contain the soul. Hallelujah, that's a little introduction. God made us humans in His image. Say, I'm made in God's image. That's what God said Himself. Okay, not God created three kinds of living things. Humans, animals, and plants. And God loved them all because God created them. But none, the animals and plants are not made in God's image. Only people, that's you and I, we are created in God's image. That means a lot of things. And one of the meaning is, we are just like God, three in one. Because God is a triune God. Three in one. Father, Son, Holy Spirit. You can say amen. So we are also triune being. Spirit, soul, and body. Hallelujah. The human being is spirit, soul, and body, and God is concerned about all three aspects of our being. Don't misunderstand me and think, oh, God don't care about my body. God cares about your body. God knows that you need a body. That He gives you, He gives you your body. You are to take care of your body. I'm supposed to take care of my body. Though it's the least important. Say least important. Okay, in comparison to your soul and your body, and your soul and your spirit, this body is least important, but we are still to take care of it. But the devil has perverted our minds, and many of us is giving most attention to our least important part. Spirit, soul, and body, if you ask me, I believe our spirit is most important. Our soul is second important, and our body is thirdly important. But the devil, as usual, will constantly work hard to teach us opposite of what God wants us to learn. God wants us to give most attention to our spirit and least attention to our bodies. But we today, many of us, including Christians, we are giving most attention to our bodies. We work so hard to build our bodies, keep our bodies healthy. And we eat all the best food. You know what I'm saying? So that's why I need to fast, and I'm going to keep on fasting until the Holy Spirit tells me to stop fasting. Right, let's turn to the book of Deuteronomy chapter 4, please, which I read earlier before I sent the children's church people out. I'm going to read a little bit about our soul. This verse speaks about the part of us that thinks, our thoughts, our will, our emotions. Deuteronomy chapter 4 verse 28, we worship. You know, when we stand before God like just now in songs and worship, we are worshiping. Our soul is worshiping. Our spirit is containing the soul that is worshiping God. Our bodies may be expressing our worship. Our bodies are not really worshiping God. Yeah? The true worshippers worship in spirit and in truth. Who can say amen? Our bodies are just manifesting the real part of us that worshiping. That is our spirit, our soul in our spirit that's worshiping God. Hallelujah. That's where sometimes the worshiping time, when you're praying, when you study God's word, that's where you begin your spiritual senses. Your spiritual senses, the five senses I mentioned earlier, become sharpened. You begin to see things and hear. That's why it's important, I always say, it's important to have quiet time with God every single day. Say every single day. It's important. That's where you're sharpening your spiritual senses. It's important, that's where you start seeing things. Like I experience a lot of my senses become very vulnerable types of worship. Or times when I have my quiet time daily, when I wake up in the morning at 3 o'clock in the morning, when the Holy Spirit says, go and pray, I rush to my office and pray. My spiritual senses become very sharp those times. And it's important to have a sharpened five spiritual senses. Deuteronomy chapter 4, verse 28 to 30, the Word of God says, there you will worship men make gods of wood and stones which cannot see or hear or eat or smell. Verse 29, but if from there you will seek the Lord your God, you will find Him. If you seek Him with all your heart and with all your soul. Say, all my soul.
All my soul.
And one of the major reasons why we have a soul is to seek God. We have a will to make the right decisions in related to God. That's why we have a soul. Not just to enjoy human relationships, which is not a bad thing. Not just to get married and have kids and all this. We have emotions. Our souls are involved in all of these. But ultimately our souls exist within us, which is to interact with God. All of our souls. Hallelujah. Verse 30. When you are in distress and as these things have happened to you, then in later days you will return to the Lord your God and obey Him. Tell your friend, your soul is immortal. Come on. Immortal. Immortal means tak boleh mati. Yeah? For soul is jiwa. See, spirit is roh. And tubuh is your flesh. Yeah, manusia punya tiga bahagian. Roh, jiwa, dan tubuh. Okay. Let's turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 1 to 5 and see. We're going to read a little bit about this flesh, this tubo, this the daging. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 1 to 5, and the Word of God says this. For we know that if the earthly tent, if you study deeper in these verses, it's not talking about your house. It's talking about your flesh, your body. Okay, if you go and do your research and study, some people interpret this as their house. No, it's not. It's talking about your flesh. If you go deeper into the original Greek. For we know that if the earthly tent, everyone say, earthly body.
Earthly body.
Okay? We live in and destroyed, we have a building from God. A new body is on your way, Sharon Tan. A new body is on your way, Caleb. So this body is stamped as it is. God had promised. God makes this promise all over in the scriptures. It's okay if wrinkles are building up on your face. We try our best not to reduce them. Do whatever you can, but don't give too much attention, but try. But still, it's gonna go. You know, breastfeeding mother, your breast is gonna sag. You know, you give birth, you put on weight. Yeah, that's part and parcel of being a mother, you know. Try our best to look good, but at the end of the day, you have to remember, it's gonna go. And a lot of women struggle. The older you get, you feel less attractive. Oh, you know, let the Lord just renew your minds and to fix your eyes on the new body that's going to come. You're going to look better than Miss Universe. Who can say amen?
Amen.
Perfect body, yeah? Amen. Maggie, perfect body is on the way. Hallelujah. Praise Jesus. For me as well, not just Maggie. Okay, hallelujah. We have a building from God. Same verse 1, yeah? An eternal house, which speaks of an eternal heavenly body. Your next body is immortal. Okay, it's going to last forever. That's only 2, this body that you have, and the next body is going to be forever. This one is temporary. The next one is not temporary, it's forever. Not built by human hands. Verse 2. Meanwhile, we groan. So while we are in this body, there's aches, there's pain sometimes before. We groan, you know, I don't like this body, I feel tired sometimes. This body is earthly, it's meant to be like that. Yeah, so we groan, we complain, we're getting older. Last time I can do, not me, some of you, I can still do. Sometimes last time you can run 1 mile without nothing. Now 1 mile you run, you cannot breathe. You know, say it like real life. Okay, verse 2. Meanwhile, we groan longing to be clothed instead with our heavenly dwelling. So thank God, God has given us His promise and we know a new body is coming. Say amen.
Amen.
If you believe, it's God's word. Yes, Alex, new body is coming. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Verse 3. Because when we are clothed, we will not be found naked. Oh, now he explains why all of us have to put on clothes. Because with this earthly body, you are actually naked. It's in the scriptures. This was a revelation to me. So I didn't question. Hey, why do we wear clothes? Huh? Yeah, we're connected to Adam and Eve when they sinned and started putting leaves all over the place. You know, the Bible says they put leaves all over the place because after they sinned, they were ashamed, they were hiding. But not just that. From this verse, you realize that actually our earthly body is naked. And when it's naked, it has to be clothed. But the new body, do you know that when you receive a new body, you don't have to wear clothes? Say, wow, come on, say wow. Don't you know that? You know, so everything equally, you know, there's no saying, oh, you are Gucci, I am Gucci, whatever it is. So nobody can be better than the other. Oh, mine, I'm designer outfit, yours not. You know, no, we don't need clothes in the new body. We've been surrounded by light, God's light. It is 1 billion times better than Gucci. Who can say amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Look at that. Verse 3 again. Because when we are clothed, meaning with the new body, we will not be found naked. No wonder all of you, just imagine all of you came to church without clothes today, I'll drop dead. You know what I'm saying? So we all have to put on clothes. It's just imagine I came to church and preached without clothes. You know, so we have to have clothes because the fact is, this earthly body is naked. It's naked. You have to say so. So it makes sense why we're wearing clothes. Verse 4. For while we are in this tent, we groan and are burdened because we do not wish to be unclothed, but to be clothed instead with our heavenly dwelling. So that what is mortal, this current body which is mortal, may be swallowed up by life. Verse 5. Now the one who has fashioned us, which is God, for this very purpose is God, who has given us the Spirit. So when you are born again, your spirit comes alive, and God gives us the Holy Spirit. It's not human spirit. This is the Holy Spirit. This word spirit here in this verse talks about the Holy Spirit. Amen. When you get born again, the Holy Spirit comes. Look at that verse again, verse 5. Now the one who has fashioned us from this very purpose is God, who has given us the Spirit. And if I'm not wrong, you have capital S Spirit. Whenever you see capital S Spirit in your Bible, it speaks about the Holy Spirit. Say amen.
Amen.
Whenever the Bible is speaking to you about your human spirit, small s, so don't get confused. It is the Holy Spirit as a deposit. Say deposit.
Yes.
So one of the reasons the Holy Spirit fills us for many beautiful reasons. Who can say amen?
Amen.
One of it is, it's actually a deficit, saying that I'm real. I filled you with my spirit, the Holy Spirit. I'm going to come back. I'm going to change this body. My son is going to come back. That's, the Holy Spirit is a deficit. So we need the Holy Spirit guaranteeing what is to come. Say thank you, Jesus. Come on. Thank you, Jesus. One out of the three parts of our being, I mentioned earlier, our current body that we have is not coming with us into the next life. The current body we have is mortal, and it's meant for this earth. And when the last trumpet is blown, the wise virgins, the dead and alive, will receive a brand new body, immortal heavenly bodies that is meant for heaven. Our body and our spirit have similar purpose, which is to contain or house the soul, and the function of the body and spirit is to experience and respond to the five senses, be it physical or spiritual senses. Listen to Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verse 7. And look at this verse. Even right in the Old Testament, God reminds us of the truth that our flesh is just dust. Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verse 7. And the word of God says this. And for those who do not know, Ecclesiastes is a book of wisdom. I mean, those who want to become wise, one of the books to study is the book of Ecclesiastes. It tells you to be wise. And the wise will hold on to the truth. That this truth says, and the dust returns to the ground it came from. And the spirit, which is your spirit, that you have a spirit and a body, but that body is going to go to the ground. But that spirit that you have right now, and for all of us who are born again, our spirit is alive. The spirit is not going to go to the ground. Alright, the spirit returns to God who gave it. Who can say amen? Come on, say amen. Yeah. Let's tell your friends seriously now. Give attention to your spirit more than your body. Come on, tell your friend that. Give attention to your spirit more than your body. Hallelujah. And start today. For those of you who know who you are, no one should judge anybody here. We have to judge ourselves. You know that you have been giving so much attention to your body and nothing much to your spirit. Today is the day to wake up and say, I'm going to do it. I'm going to give you attention to my spirit. Because this dust, this is going to be dust. It's wasted, you know. You can go to the plastic surgery and everything, all that. Thousands of dollars is going to go, that's it. Let's invest our time and talent and treasures on how to build our spirit, which is not going to go to the ground like our bodies, but it's going to go back to God. God's word tells us that our bodies will be left behind, together with all that we have that belongs to this earth. This body is for this earth. Your house is for this earth. You're not going to take to heaven your house. You're not going to take to heaven your cars. You're not going to take to heaven your marriages, for your information. In heaven, there's no such thing as husband and wife. We are all brothers and sisters with one Father, and that is God, who can say amen. Okay, you're not going to take to that. So give less attention to things that's meant for this earth. Okay? Give less attention. And God's words clearly tells us that our spirit will have to return to the Father when this earthly life expires. Yet sadly, we are giving so much, maybe too much probably, attention to our temporary bodies and so little attention to our spirit. Let's please turn to Matthew chapter 3, 16. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Matthew chapter 3, 16. We'll read all the way to the next chapter, chapter 4, verse 1 to 4, we end verse 4. As soon as Jesus was baptized, Jesus also was baptized before he began his ministry, he was baptized. And for those of you who believe in Jesus and you have not been baptized, you need to be baptized. Okay, baptism is like marriage. Baptism doesn't make you a Christian. What makes you a Christian? When you accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you get born again, that makes you a Christian. But baptism is telling the whole world, now I'm a Christian. Like when Pastor Amanda was my girlfriend, we did not get married yet. I cannot tell the whole world she's mine. So when I married her on the 28th of December 1996, I was telling the whole world, now she's mine and I'm hers. When you get baptized, that's what you are doing. You are declaring to the people around you. that I belong to Jesus. It's no secret from now on. That's what baptism is all about. It doesn't save you, but it's a powerful declaration. Who can say amen? So for those who have not been baptized, you should consider baptism. And if you're interested, see one of the leaders. See the pastors or the leaders. Okay? So as soon as Jesus was baptized, he went up out of the water and back. When you think of baptism, it's always water. You need water to be baptized. It's biblical. At that moment, heaven was opened and he saw the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit, descending like a dove. Everyone say like a dove. I always say this, the Holy Spirit is not a dove. The Holy Spirit is a person. Just as God the Father is a person, God the Son is a person, God the Holy Spirit is a person. The Holy Spirit is not a dove. It's like a dove. It's as gentle as a dove. So that's why you need to understand that so that you can have a relationship with the Holy Spirit. Like a dove, and verse 2. Holy Spirit of God descending like a dove and alighting on him. So in other words, Jesus was baptized and he was filled with the Holy Spirit. Say amen. In the next chapter, chapter 4, verse 1. Then Jesus was led by the Spirit. This is very important. The next verse, pay attention. Then Jesus was led by the Holy Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil after fasting. So notice that the first thing that Jesus did after being filled with the Holy Spirit is to fast. Tell your friend beside you, he fasted for 40 days. Come on. He fasted for 40 days. Have you ever wondered why? So when you are born again, when Jesus got baptized in water and the Spirit of God filled him, the first thing he did was not just do ministry. He fasted away from food. Jesus has this revelation and just as how we need to have. That is, we have a body and a spirit, not just a body. This I need to give less attention. This happened, his baptism and being filled by the Spirit happened when he was 30 years old. So prior to that, he was not filled with the Spirit. Okay, he was filled with the Spirit when he was 30. And he only ran his ministry for 3 years. 30 to 33, that's where he was put to the cross and died. 3 years. So he was filled with the Spirit. The first thing he did was not go for a buffet and feed his flesh, which he already fed his flesh for 30 years. He realized that I have a spirit. So I need to put aside feeding this flesh. I put enough attention to this flesh. I need to go away from food. How many of you, the first temptation that Jesus had was what? Turn this stone into bread. Who can say amen? The first temptation that he had was to eat. Here he's in the desert for 40 days, I must not eat. Because I want to give less attention to my flesh than what I'm doing, I'm trying to do. The grace of God. This is not my life, I'm fasting. So Jesus did just that. So we had a conversation, my wife and I said, how, I still don't have this powerful revelation why we need to fast. Remember this last week, I think, and I was sharing with her a little bit of what I'm sharing with you right now. When we fast, we are saying, flesh, take a break. Take a break. Spirit, it's your turn now. It's your turn to be fed. It's your turn to drink. It's your turn to eat. That's what Jesus did. So fasting is good. Not for pregnant mothers, huh? Please don't fast. The rest of you can fast. Okay, so Jesus did that. He fasted for 40 days, not 4 days. Not like me, I'm still eating one meal a day. Jesus fasted completely. Whoa! Amazing Jesus. Okay, verse 4, chapter 1 again. Chapter 4, verse 1. Then Jesus was led by the Spirit to the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. Verse 2. After fasting for 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry. Verse 3, the tempter, the devil, came to him and said, if you are the Son of God, tell these stones to become bread. Jesus answered, it is written, man shall not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God. This gives us a clue. What is food to the Spirit? This verse, and many other verses. What is food to the Spirit? God's word. Say God's word. No wonder some of you are falling asleep in church because the devil doesn't want you to eat. The devil doesn't want your spirit to eat. No wonder you're sleeping. Each time you turn to your Bible, you are sleeping. Each time you on the, you are stitched on the internet or your Facebook, you become so alive. Because the devil doesn't want you to feed your spirit. The devil wants to feed your flesh and your flesh alone. So you want to know how to feed your spirit? Come to church. The that preaches God's word. In this church, we preach God's word, and God's word alone can say amen. I don't tell you my experience, I just, there's many verses I give to you and explain. And when you have quiet time, you read God's word. I know there are many great devotional books, but nothing beats the Bible. Nothing beats the Bible. Allow the Spirit of God to just explain to you something you don't understand, but it's okay, persevere. The Holy Spirit will give you insights upon insights as you read God's word. So you need to start reading God's word, because it fits your spirit. Don't leave your hands up, but how, when was the last time you on your own read the Bible? Don't leave your hands up. Don't embarrass you. I bet many people have not read the Bible for a while. Don't come in church on your own. It's not just because you're a bad Christian, because there's somebody behind you, which is the devil, who is stopping you from feeding your spirit. And it's real. It's biblical. It's a roaring lion. He doesn't want you to grow, Sharon. He doesn't want you to grow, Lucy. He doesn't want you to grow, Punita. So you've got to read the Bible. He doesn't want you to grow, Project. He wants you to stay spiritually dead. Or even you are born again, it's okay, it's born again by spiritual baby. How much can baby Asher do? Baby Asher is totally dependent on the mother. You put baby Asher alone on the room and without feeding, baby Asher will die. Are you listening? Baby Asher is so needy of the mother, and that's nature. So if you're a spiritual baby, child, I'm born again. If you're born again, you accepted Jesus, and you're a spiritual baby, you're not going to last long. You need to grow. And how do you grow? In God's word. Every day. And I've been saying this many times, so not the first time to say it. You have to study God's word. Don't give yourself excuses. I'm too busy with ministry. I'm too busy doing marriage. I'm too busy doing parent. I'm so busy with my career. Don't allow yourself to buy all those lies of the devil. Don't stay spiritually young. It's in the Bible. You have to grow and start eating spiritual meat. Who can say amen?
Amen.
Tell your friend beside you, let's start studying God's word. Come on. Let's start studying God's word, because it fits your spirit. It fits your spirit. And let's begin today. Okay, as you go out tonight, find time to read your Bible. Find time. Nothing beats that. Nothing is more important than that. Nothing. Hallelujah. Your spirit is going to go with you the next life. Okay? Skip your dinner. Skip supper. Whatever it is. Skip TV. Skip whatever you can, so you can spend time feeding your spirit. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Please turn to Galatians chapter 5, verse 13 to 18. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Especially in these last days, guys, we cannot afford not to feed our spirit. Yeah? Cannot afford. Cannot afford. We have to get serious with feeding our spirit. Galatians chapter 5, verse 13 to 18. You, my brothers and sisters, so whenever you read the word of God, it says brothers and sisters, it means it's for Christians. Not every word in the scriptures are for, but this is for Christians. So Christians, pay attention, all of you. All of you here are Christians. Tell your friend beside you, you're a Christian. Come on, this is for you. Come on. You're a Christian. This is for you. All of you, okay? All of you. You, my brothers and sisters, were called to be free. Okay? Real freedom. Only Christians have real freedom. When you believe in Jesus as your Lord, you have real freedom. And you have it. In Jesus' name, all of you have it. But do not use your freedom to indulge the flesh. Stop giving attention to your flesh. You have the freedom now. Rather serve one another humbly in love. Verse 14, for the entire law is fulfilled in keeping this one command. Love your neighbor as yourself. Verse 15, if you bite and devour each other, watch out or you will be destroyed by each other. Verse 16, so I say, walk by the Spirit. You are born again, you have the Holy Spirit. Here, big S. Okay, the Spirit here is not talking about your spirit. Walk by the leading of the Holy Spirit that's living inside of you. Read that again. Verse 16, so I say, walk by the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of your flesh. If you want to learn how to not give too much attention to your flesh, the way is to actually listen to the Holy Spirit. Every day, not on Sundays like this. Not enough. 7 days a week. One of the first things I do in the morning, I always share with you, say, Holy Spirit, come and fill me. Today, a brand new day you have given me. The Father has given me a brand new day. Holy Spirit, fill me once again and lead me today. So the only way for us to know how to give less attention to our flesh and more attention to our spirit is to be led by the Holy Spirit. And we have to ask Him, come, Holy Spirit, I need you. Someone was inspired by this truth long time ago and wrote this old hymn. Come, sweet Spirit, I pray. Come with your strength and your power. Come in your own gentle way. Sing this song every day. If you're not a singer, then sing this song. Come on, Spirit, I need you. Come, sweet Spirit, I pray. Come with your strength and your power. Come in your own gentle way. Say it in the morning when you wake up. Because it takes less than a minute. You just got to believe that God hears you when you sing the song and say it or say this prayer. And the Holy Spirit is going to come. For the word of God says, ask and you shall receive. Who can say amen? Amen. Then 1 hour, come Holy Spirit, come on, come on. Just wanted to sing the song. Driving your car, come. Holy Spirit, I need you. Ask the Holy Spirit to come, because the Holy Spirit knows how to teach us. He's the only teacher, He's the best teacher to teach us how to give attention to our spirit and less attention to our flesh. Verse 16 again, so I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of your flesh. Flesh means body. Verse 17, for the flesh desires, listen, the flesh desires what is contrary to the Spirit. What the Holy Spirit wants for you, the flesh don't want. The Holy Spirit says you must forgive. The flesh says don't forgive. Why should I forgive? Why should I forgive? The flesh says, the Holy Spirit says, ten times with Jesus, the flesh says, nah, I'm lazy, I'm tired. It's always opposite. Contrary means opposite. Okay, it doesn't agree. The flesh is, and then yet we are giving so much attention to the flesh. It's opposite to what the Holy Spirit wants, but we are giving attention to the flesh. Hallelujah. Verse 17, for the flesh desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the flesh. They are in conflict with each other, so that you are not to do whatever you want. Whatever you, the Spirit wants, you won't. The flesh says, don't do it, don't do it. Verse 18, but if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. Hallelujah. Come on, tell someone new. Let us be led by the Holy Spirit daily. Come on. Let us be led by the Holy Spirit daily. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Let's turn to the next verse, John chapter 6, verse 55 to 58. John chapter 6, verse 55 to 58, the word of God says this, for my flesh is real food, Jesus says, and my blood is real drink. 56, whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood remains in me and in I in them. Only through God and in God we have real food and real drink for our spirit, okay? For our spirit, talking about food for and drink for our spirit. Verse 57, just as the living Father sent me and I live because of the Father, so the one who feeds on me, when we feed on Jesus, whenever we study the Bible, we are studying Jesus. Because the Jesus is the Word becoming flesh. Who can say amen? Amen. So when you read a book, you're not reading a book. When you read the Bible, you're not reading a book. You are reading Jesus. Get it? When you read the Bible, truly, I say truly, listen, you are reading Jesus. Because Jesus is the Word. That Word, God's Word, becoming flesh. So the Bible is not just a book. So that's when you have to spend time doing that. Verse 57, just as the living Father sent me and I live because of the Father, so the one who feeds on me, Jesus says, will live because of me. You need to feed on Jesus. Mesti baca firman Tuhan. Tada alasan, ya? Verse 58, this is the bread. Firman Tuhan ialah roti. Untuk rohani. Rohani. Makanan rohani. Bukan hanya makanan jasmani. Makanan rohani perlu. Verse 58, this is the bread that come down from heaven. Your ancestors ate manna and died. But whoever feeds on this bread will live forever. Everyone say forever.
Forever.
Yes. Your spirit will live forever. Not just forever, but forever with God. For eternity. Thank you, Jesus. John chapter 4, verse 15, and it skipped to verse 22 to 24. You want to read a little about the Samaritan woman at the well. She talked about thirsty. She went to look for water, and Jesus says, I'm going to give you real water. Only through God, through Jesus, there is real food. Through Jesus, there is real drink. Through Jesus, there is food and drink for your spirit, which is a real part of you, which is me. Verse 15, John chapter 4. The woman said to him, Sir, give me this water. After Jesus explained, I have a special water. You can drink it, you will never be thirsty again. And the woman said, she's wise, she wants it. Some people, they hear about this water and then they don't want this water. And today you are hearing it. This woman is wise, she's an adult, she's like an adulteress. She has the man that she's living with now is the sixth man. And they are not married and they're having sex. But yet, she was wise. In the sense where you heard about this spiritual drink. So I want, she said. She became an evangelist eventually. Straight away she became an evangelist. She left that pill and she ran and started evangelizing. She said, there is a Savior who's here, who's here to Jesus. She was the first Samaritan evangelist in history. This woman at the well. Sir, give me this water so that I won't get thirsty and have to keep coming here to draw water. Jump to verse 30, 22 below. You Samaritans worship what you do not know. We worship what we do know. For salvation is from the Jews. Verse 23, yet a time is coming and has now come when true worshippers will worship the Father in spirit. Everyone say spirit.
Spirit.
And this is big S. Spirit here. In spirit, which speaks about true worshippers need to have the Holy Spirit. Yeah? It's not enough to say, I have Jesus. I have Jesus, but no Holy Spirit. We need both. That's why Jesus left behind the Holy Spirit. This is what Jesus now said, true worshippers. Ask your friend now, are you a true worshipper? Come on, ask. Are you a true worshipper? And if you are a true worshipper, Jesus said this. This is his word. True worshippers worship in spirit and in truth. Who is the truth? Who is the way, the truth, and the life?
Jesus.
Hallelujah. You are not a true worshipper if you have no Jesus and you have no Holy Spirit. You can never be a true worshipper. True worshippers worship in spirit and in truth. Hallelujah. For they are the kind of worshippers the Father seeks. Allah Baba is looking for the kind of worshippers that has the Holy Spirit and has Jesus in their life. Verse 25. God is spirit and his worshippers must. Everyone say must. Not if you like. If you like, then you. No, must. You need the Holy Spirit. You need Jesus. Verse 24 again, God is spirit and his worshippers must worship in spirit and in truth. Hallelujah. Let's go to John chapter 6, verse 35 to 37. John chapter 6, verse 35 to 37, and the word of God says this. Then Jesus declared, I am the bread of life. Amen. Are you hungry? Are you spiritually hungry? Run to Jesus. Eat, go and have a spiritual buffet. Tonight, go have a spiritual buffet. Study God's word. Hallelujah. I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry. And whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. Verse 36. But as I told you, you have seen me and still you do not believe. Verse 37. All those the Father gives me will come to me. And whoever comes to me, I will never drive away. Whoever comes to Jesus, he will never drive away. You can be a prostitute before. You can be a transgender. You can be a rapist. You can be a murderer, a liar, a gossiper. It's God's word. Whoever, anyone comes to me, I will never drive away. Who can say amen?
Amen.
That's the mercy and grace of God. The next chapter, John chapter 7, please. Verse 37 to 40. On the last and greatest day of the festival, Jesus stood and said in a loud voice. When he said in a loud voice, come on, but listen. The Bible, put it down, loud voice. Let anyone who is thirsty come to me and drink. 38, whoever believes in me, a scripture has said, rivers of living water will flow from within. Listen very carefully. Now speaking a lot of, now this verse is about drinking. Rivers of water is going to flow through me. So you understand that through Jesus and His word you eat. So this verse and some other verse is about how you drink. Okay? Verse 39. By this He meant the Spirit, the Holy Spirit. So whenever you pray in the Spirit, not just in tongues, you can pray through the Holy Spirit in tongues. You can also pray in the Holy Spirit through understanding. Do you know that? You can pray in the Holy Spirit in English. Doesn't mean pray in the Spirit have to be Shakar Namabarekeya Namabor Namabor. Pray in the Spirit means you are being led by the Holy Spirit. That's what it means. So you can be led by the Holy Spirit or in tongues or even in understanding. It's in the Bible. In understanding means you are praying in English or in Chinese or in sign language. That's pray in the Spirit means you are being led by the Spirit. You can say amen. Come on, say amen.
Amen.
So whenever you are being led by the Spirit in prayer or praise or worship, you are actually drinking. Amen. You don't have to eat. Just like the flesh needs food and drink. Just as the soul needs mommy's love and daddy's love. Your spirit also needs food and drink. So don't just study the word of God. You need to pray. Keep on praying. Ephesians 6:18. In the Spirit. At all times, with all kinds of prayer. Who can say amen?
Amen.
Tell your friend, tell your brother, you must pray. Come on, you must pray. Tell him again or her again, praying is drinking for your spirit. Come on, praying is drinking for your spirit. So don't just study God's word. Have a balance. How would Jesha be if Jesha's good age. How would Jesha be if Jesha just drank without eating? Or if Jesha act without drinking. There must be a balance, right? Amen? So you have to study, find time. If you have half an hour quiet time a day, spend 15 minutes studying God's word and 15 minutes praying. 15 minutes feeding your spirit and 15 minutes giving your spirit a drink. Pray. Yeah, pray. So be wise in how you manage your time. To feed your spirit and give drink to your spirit. Okay, let's pray right now. John 7, right? John 7, verse 38. Is it? Yeah. Verse 38, John 7, 38. Please, let's go there. Whoever believes in me, as scripture has said, rivers of living water will flow from within them. Verse 39, by this he, Jesus, meant the Holy Spirit, whom those who believe in him were later to receive. Up to that time, the Spirit had not been given yet, since Jesus had not yet been glorified. So you can eat and you can drink. Wow! Your spirit will never be thirsty again. Your spirit will never be hungry again. Today you know this truth. Okay, that's why it's so important to pray and to study God's word. Let's go to Romans chapter 8, verse 26, please. I'm going to finish soon. Second last verse. Romans chapter 8 and verse 26, and the word of God says this. In the same way, the Spirit helps us in our weakness. The Holy Spirit helps us when you are weak. Weak means when you have problems, when you are sick, when you are depressed, you are sad, when you are horny, you are lustful, when you are angry, whatever it is that we have now and then. The same way the Spirit helps us in our weakness. We do not know what we ought to pray for, but the Spirit Himself intercedes for us through our wordless groans. Verse 27. So God knows how much we need to drink. In other words, God knows how much we need to pray. But sometimes we just don't know how to pray in English. I just don't know what to say. I'm so angry, like I was angry this morning with my daughter. I just don't know how to pray. So I just went to God and just prayed in the Spirit a little bit. And just the rivers of water just filled with me. And the anger just subsided. Hallelujah. Verse 27. Thank you, Jesus. And he who searches our hearts knows the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for God's people in accordance and the will of God. Now I want to encourage those of you who are not praying in tongues yet. It's time to pray in tongues. Okay, for those of you who are praying in tongues, it's time. Okay, you just have to ask God, teach me how to pray in tongues. Because there will be days when you just don't know how to pray in understanding. You're so angry with your husband. I don't know how to pray. I'm so angry. How to tell you how to talk to God? You just pray in tongues. You pray in tongues. That's how you pray in tongues. That's what the Bible says. Groan. You groan. When you pray in tongues, you make sounds. You're groan. You're angry. You're so angry with your husband who did something that makes you so mad. You You have no time. You don't know how to pray. You don't know what to choose. So just you need to pray in the Spirit. And listen, whenever the Spirit prays perfect prayers. Who can say amen? When you pray not in the Spirit, your prayers will have flaws. Because you don't know we are human. We are imperfect. Imperfect people pray imperfect prayers. But when you pray by the Spirit, your prayers will be perfect. You need to pray in the Spirit. Especially in tongues. There are things in the Spirit in tongues. Verse 27 again. And he who searches our hearts knows the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for God's people in accordance with the will of God. Last but not least, John chapter 1, verse 14. I'm going to close with this. The Word became flesh. Let's talk about Jesus. Why you need to read the Word? Because you're reading Jesus. That's the flesh. That's God Himself in the person of Jesus. The Word became flesh and made His dwelling among us. We have seen His glory, the glory of the one and only Son, who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. Let's all rise up.